Matthew 16, and we'll read from verse 13. Matthew 16, verse 13. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do you think you are?" Oh, sorry. I got one of those bad translations again. That does sound a little bit familiar, though, doesn't it? That's what we're being taught today. You got to find out who you are. Get in touch with yourself. Even know who you are in Christ. Well, there's some truth to this, but I think we're becoming unbalanced. We're getting the emphasis upon self, as we've noticed in this series. And we're being turned subtly from God to ourselves, from the truth to the lie, from real faith to some kind of a mind power. And Jesus didn't say to the disciples, and he never emphasized to his disciples, what you need to do is get to know who you are, get in touch with your feelings, get in touch with this potential that you have within you. But he said to them, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? I think the Lord would ask us the same question today. He asked his disciples, "What are people saying about me? Who do they think I am?" And he expected that his disciples should know what people were saying about him. And I think that we ought to know today what people are saying about Jesus. It's absolutely essential that they know who Jesus is. Not only know who he is, but that they know him. Remember, Jesus said, "This is life eternal," in John 17, "that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent." The Bible emphasizes understanding more than it emphasizes experiences. One of our problems today, I believe in experiences. I've had some tremendous experiences with God. I've seen miracles. But you can't go by experiences. A lot of people have a lot of experiences, and we can't take our experience and then make that the criteria by which we interpret the Word of God. But our experience has to be interpreted by the Bible, not the other way around. And the Bible emphasizes understanding. And I think one of the problems in our churches today is there's not much understanding. There's a lot of emotionalism, a lot of appeal to people's emotions, but people are not learning to think for themselves. For example, we won't take time to turn to it. It's a verse that every Christian ought to know. Jeremiah 9, verse 24. Well, verse 23 says, "Let not the wise glory in his wisdom. Let not the wealthy glory in his wealth. Let not the mighty glory in his might." Unfortunately, these are the things that we tend to glory in. "But let him that glorieth glory in this, that I came into his bedroom last night and he got all goosebumpy as I overwhelmed him with my presence and he had a tremendous mystical experience." Is that what it says? Those of you that know Jeremiah 9:24, what does it say? "Let him that glorieth glory in this, that he knoweth me." It doesn't even say that. "Let him that glorieth glory in this, that he understandeth and knoweth me. I am the Lord who exercise loving kindness." Yes, he's a God of love, but then he says, "justice and judgment, righteousness in this earth." And they go together. And if you went to Matthew 13, you remember the parable of the sower who went forth to sow, and the first seed that he sowed fell by the wayside where the footsteps of those who walked across the plowed soil had trampled it down, and the seed couldn't sink in, and the birds of the air came and took it away. And the disciples said, "Lord, tell us, what does this mean?" And Jesus said, When anyone hears the word of the kingdom, he said, hear the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom, and he doesn't go forward, he doesn't get emotional, he doesn't tarry all night, he doesn't weep. What did he say? When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not. I think very often we try to get people to come to a Jesus that we haven't explained who he is, and to make a commitment that we have not thoroughly explained to them what that is all about. And I see this very often on Christian television, where we have a very short time in the last 30 seconds perhaps, or the last minute, to lead someone in a sinner's prayer, and they haven't really, no groundwork has been laid. They've had some emotional singing, some sentimental songs, they've had some testimonies, but they've had very little instruction as to who Jesus is and why he came and what he demands of us and the commitment they're expected to make. And they're led through a superficial, very quick prayer, and on that basis, people have an emotional experience and they think they've come to know Jesus and they haven't come to know him. And that's why so many people fall away and they don't follow through. And Jesus said, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then comes the wicked one and takes away out of the heart. This is not Dave Hunt, the fanatic. I've been accused of seeing a demon under every bush, you know. But Jesus said, Satan himself, the wicked one, takes right out of the heart the seed that was sown, and it will not spring to life and it will not bear fruit. And we could go on. There are many other scriptures. Acts 26, verse 18. Again, I'm giving you scriptures that I think every Christian ought to know by heart. When Jesus called Saul and he turned him into Paul the apostle and he sent him out to win souls to the Jews and to the Gentiles, he says, to whom I now send thee to do three things: to open their eyes, to turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan to God. And only then did Jesus say, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among them that are sanctified through faith that is in me. Unless people's eyes have been opened, they've been turned from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, they will not receive forgiveness of sins. And we're talking them into something that they don't understand, and they're making a commitment that is not going to last. And you get it again in 1 John chapter 5, where Jesus says, we are of God, and the whole world lies in the wicked one. We like to sing that song, he's got the whole wide world in his hands. But my Bible tells me that Satan has the whole wide world in his hands. He is the god of this world who blinds the minds of those who believe not. He is that old serpent, the devil, Revelation 12, who deceives the whole world. And John writes and he says, we are of God, and the whole world lies in the wicked one. And then he says, and we know that the Son of God has come and has given us a tremendous emotional experience. I believe in emotional experiences. I believe if Jesus suddenly stood right here, we would all fall at his feet. If President Reagan walked in, whether you're a Democrat or a Republican, you would stand in honor of him. But if Jesus appeared, you will fall at his feet. There's a big difference between Jesus and a president or a king. And there would be emotion. I'm not against emotion. I'm against emotionalism. It's like having a football team and they've got an exciting game going and everybody's cheering themselves hoarse. And so they decide, well, why don't we come back tomorrow night? But there's no team on the field, nothing's happening, but you got the cheerleaders out there and everybody's cheering, but nothing's going on. You can work yourself up into something that has no basis in reality. And John writes and he says, we know that the Son of God has come and has given us what? An understanding, that we might know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even in his Son, Jesus Christ. And then he says, this is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. That's a problem in the church today and in the world today. There are false gods and even people who claim to be little gods. So Jesus was asking his disciples something of the utmost importance. Who do people think I am? What are they saying about me? Well, what were they saying? They were saying some really ridiculous things. Verse 14, they said, some say you're John the Baptist. Now, you had to be badly informed to think that Jesus was John the Baptist. They were cousins. John the Baptist had baptized Jesus. They were contemporaries. And yet Herod the king, who had his spies everywhere, who was supposed to be one of the best informed men in Judea, in Palestine, he thought, when he heard of the miracles that Jesus did, that Jesus was John the Baptist raised from the dead. A crazy idea. But can you believe that there are people in the world today who have just as crazy ideas about who Jesus is? Others say, you're Elijah, or Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. Apparently they believed in reincarnation. Reincarnation is a belief that is growing in popularity in our world today. It's said in the latest poll that over 50% of the people in Western Europe now believe in reincarnation. I think it's approaching that in the United States. And it's amazing how many people who call themselves Christians believe in reincarnation. You can't believe in resurrection and reincarnation. They're unalterably opposed. Of course, the Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die, and after this, the judgment. Reincarnation is an attempt to avoid the judgment and to have another time that you can come back and try again and again and again. I was recently on a secular network in Southern California, and we were having a debate with some reincarnationists. And as I walked into the television studio, a woman came running up to me out there in the street, and she said, oh, Brother Hunt, I was where you were speaking last Sunday, and oh, it was tremendous. Wow, what a message you gave. And my father was a minister, but I've never heard anything like that, and so forth. Well, she was in the audience, and when the hostess asked, how many people out here in the audience today believe in reincarnation? And they raised their hands. I saw her hand go up. And the assistant pastor who had introduced me that Sunday morning at a very fine evangelical church had his elderly aunt stand up and had told the congregation, she was visiting, had told the congregation what a godly woman she was, what a godly influence she'd been in his life. She was in the audience, and I saw her hand go up. Why is this belief in reincarnation so important? Because we're heading for a climax in the deception and the seduction that the Bible warns about, which will ultimately lead to the Antichrist taking control of this world. He's not going to have to fight it out with anyone. He will be welcomed. In fact, as we will see in our next session, he will be worshipped by the whole world. Now, I could hardly stand here and claim to be the Christ if I don't have the nail prints in my hands and feet and the spear wound in my side. You would not believe it, so long as you are looking for the resurrected Jesus. But if you were looking for the latest reincarnation of the Christ spirit that was in Buddha, that was in Rama, that was in Krishna, that was in Muhammad, that Gene Dixon says is in a man who was born 7 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, February 5th, 1962, who is living on this earth now, who will unite this world in a new positive Christianity. And I had the psychic powers to demonstrate this. You might believe. The Bible is very careful in its language. Remember in Acts chapter 1, when the disciples stood gazing up into heaven as Jesus had been taken up, you remember those two angels that stood by them? They said, of course, to them, you men of Galilee, why stand you gazing up? Don't you realize that this Christ consciousness, this Christ spirit, is going to come upon all men, and they will all realize this higher state of consciousness? What did the angels say? The language of Scripture is very precise. This same Christ, this same Jesus, this same Jesus, this man, the man Christ Jesus, he loved to call himself the Son of Man. Why is that essential? Well, we have offended infinite justice, and that requires an infinite penalty. I was reading in the paper the other day, it's incredible what's happening in our society. I don't remember how many people this man murdered, and he was given life, but he would be eligible for parole at the end of 10 years. It doesn't happen that way with God. You don't get parole. We would be separated from God forever and forever and forever. We cannot, as finite beings, pay an infinite penalty. Now, God is infinite. He could pay the penalty. But it wouldn't be just, because he's not a member of our race. So God himself became a man through the virgin birth to pay a debt that we could never pay. He never ceased to be God. He will never cease to be man. He is the one and only God-man. And there are no others. People say, well, we're the Son of God, like he's the Son of God, and he's our elder brother. Well, about 8 times in the New Testament, he is called the only begotten Son of God. We become the children of God through faith in Christ Jesus, but never in the way that Jesus himself is. And because of who he is, the God-man, the sinless Lamb of God, he could die for our sins. He could pay a debt that we could never pay. And he rose triumphant from the grave, and he wants to live his life in each of us. This, you know, is the simple gospel message of the Word of God, and there is no other way. There is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Not whereby we can, and there are other alternatives, whereby we must be saved. Reincarnation, if we can just take time, because it's a belief that you are going to encounter out there increasingly, and you need to have something to say to your friends who believe in this. And I will give you 3 simple things about reincarnation. Number 1, reincarnation and karma are amoral. Why do I say it's amoral? Because the teaching of reincarnation is, it's the law of cause and effect. What you sow, you reap. Well, the Bible says that, but there's a but in there. But somebody paid a debt, and there's forgiveness. But in reincarnation and karma, there is no forgiveness. So if I'm a husband in this life who beats his wife, karma and reincarnation will require that I come back in the next life as a wife who is beaten by her husband. If I am a murderer, I must become a victim of exactly the same murder. Now you understand what's happening. The perpetrator of a crime must become the victim of the same crime, but that means there must be another perpetrator of the crime who then must become the victim of another of that crime. That requires another perpetrator of the crime, and it goes on forever and ever and ever. Karma and reincarnation, far from solving the problem of evil, perpetuate evil. So it is amoral. Number 2, it's senseless. Have you noticed that the world is getting better? Can any of you out there remember the mistakes that you've made in your prior lives so that you're not repeating them? You're improving upon this? What's the point of having experiences in life if you don't benefit from them? And if you've got all kinds of lies back there that you've lived and you can't even remember the mistakes you made, we're not benefiting from this. The world is getting worse. We are going down, down, down. It's a senseless belief. It doesn't make sense. Well, we've got another chance to do what? To repeat the same mistakes or worse? You're not learning from the past. And number 3, it's hopeless. You see, the karma that we build up in this life requires that we live another life to work off the karma that we build up in this life. But in the process of working off the karma we build up in this life, we build up more karma, which requires another life and another life and another life and another life, and it never ends. That's why the Hindu calls it the wheel of reincarnation, from which there is no escape except yoga, said Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita. The teacher of yoga and Shiva taught yoga, Shiva the destroyer. Well, we can't go into all of that. And if you go back in the other direction, what is happening right now, where you are each sitting, and what you are wearing, and what I am saying, and the fact that I'm standing here is because our samsara, our karma, has coalesced and has brought us together, the law of cause and effect. And what happens to you in this life is the result of karma in a prior life. But that was the result of karma in a prior life, and a prior life, and a prior life, and a prior life. And when you follow this thing back to the beginning, where the Hindu says the three gunas, the three qualities of the Godhead were in perfect balance in the void, that's the nothingness out of which everything comes, and that's the nirvana to which Buddhism leads, the nothingness. And the three gunas were in perfect balance, and something happened, no one knows what it was, to cause an imbalance in the Godhead, and the prakriti, the manifestation began. And we today are all reaping the results of bad karma that began with an imbalance in the Godhead, is built into the very fabric of the universe and our lives, from which there is no escape. It is hopeless. And yet people accept this kind of thing. A young man came to me one evening. He'd been a professing Christian. I think he wanted to just kind of shake me up a little bit. And he told me that he now believed in reincarnation. He'd rejected Jesus. I'm not going to lie. Why? Jesus says you got to deny self, take up the cross, follow me to be my disciple. You got to let Jesus take control of your life. I'm not going to let Jesus have control of my life. I said, tell me about karma. I know plenty about karma. But it's a good way to deal with people. Let them tell you. Well, he said, you know, I could come back as a mosquito or a tree or something. And I looked at him and I said, you've got to be kidding. You refuse to allow Jesus Christ, who is God, who loves you and has proved his love by dying in your place so that you could be forgiven and have eternal life as a free gift. And you refuse to allow the lover of your soul to direct your life, even though he knows better than you do. He loves you and he's wiser than you do. And instead of this, you have turned yourself over to some insensible, impersonal law of karma that could turn you into a mosquito or a tree. You've got to be crazy. But this is a belief that is growing in our society because people don't think it through for themselves. And all they think of is, it's going to avoid judgment. And I will have another opportunity and another opportunity. Well, reincarnation has been a belief down through history. And as I said, you can't believe in resurrection and reincarnation. Come, if I've been reincarnated 100 times, come the resurrection, which one of those bodies will be raised? Well, whichever body is raised, I've left 99 decaying in corruption and death. They've been conquered by death. But the Word of God promises that death, the enemy, will be destroyed. And that Jesus has conquered death, and there is no body of mine that is going to be left decaying in the grave. But we have a promise of new bodies, along with a new heavens and a new earth. So it is totally amoral, it is senseless, it is hopeless, it is against the Word of God. And no one who calls himself a Christian could possibly believe in this. You must believe in Jesus resurrected, not reincarnated. Well, the next thing he said to them was, well, who do you say that I am? And I think he would ask us the same thing today. Are we communicating with people in the world around us? Are we telling them who Jesus is? If they don't know who Jesus is, they are lost forever. Do we understand what they think? You know, another idea out there is that during those silent years, the Bible, the New Testament is silent from 12 to 30. Jesus was off studying under the gurus in India. And that's where he got his great wisdom. That's an absolute lie. First of all, there's no evidence for this. Secondly, all the evidence in the Word of God refutes it. If Jesus had studied under the gurus, he would have had to give honor to the guru tradition. He would have had to talk about his guru. Every guru that has come to America talks about his guru who sent him here. But Jesus never talked about his guru. In fact, he used a term that neither the gurus nor the rabbis liked. He talked of his heavenly father. All of the gurus talk about the life of asceticism and vegetarianism and the yoga that they've been practicing in order to realize that they are God. They are men seeking to realize Godhood. Jesus was God who became a man. He's not a man trying to scramble his way up to Godhood, but he's, on the contrary, God who became a man, who laid aside his glory, and who came to this earth to die for our sins. The holiest thing that a follower of a guru can do, according to the Guru Gita, is to drink the water in which the guru has washed his feet. Jesus took water and washed his disciples' feet. A guru would never do that. He became the servant. He humbled himself unto death. A guru would never do that. He has to be carried about. And Jesus said that if we would come to him, he would give us living water, a well of water springing up into everlasting life, and he said nothing about washing his feet in it. Everything that Jesus said, everything that Jesus did, proves he did not study under the gurus. He is totally unique. And Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Well, who do you say that Jesus is? And how do you communicate with people out there? Many of us have lost communication with our friends and neighbors. And you're talking about God and they're thinking Star Wars Force. And you're not explaining it. And you think you're communicating, and you're not communicating. And you're talking about Christ, and they're thinking Christ consciousness, or Christ spirit, or something else. And unless you explain it, you are not communicating to these people. So Jesus would say to us today, do you know what men think about me? Do you know how confused they are as to who I am? And do you realize unless they know the true God and Jesus Christ whom he has sent, they will not have eternal life? And how are you explaining to them who I am so that they can understand and they can see the distinction between the truth and between the lies that they have received and been deceived by? Then Jesus goes on. Of course, Peter says, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus says, flesh and blood hasn't revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And then he says a strange thing, verse 20, then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. Why is that? Well, if they have to know who he is, why are they not to tell who he is? Because Jesus had not yet fulfilled the scriptures. And he was not going to be made known on the basis of a Madison Avenue publicity campaign. And unfortunately, that's the way some of us try to make Jesus known. If we can get enough great people, actresses and superstar heroes who say they believe in Jesus, and we can make this popular enough, why then people will of course accept this. No, you don't tell anybody who I am until I have proved it by the scriptures, Jesus said. And the day came, you remember, when he rode into Jerusalem on that donkey, and his disciples were lining the streets, crying, Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. And the Pharisees said, they're calling you the Messiah. Forbid them. And Jesus said, if I forbade them, the very stones would cry out, because this is the day for me to be made known from now on. I have fulfilled the scriptures. Of course, there were more scriptures that he would fulfill. He would hang upon the cross. He would rise from the dead. But he had fulfilled everything up to that point. And that was the modus operandi of the apostles. You'll read it in Acts 17, for example. When Paul went into the synagogue, he reasoned with them out of the scripture, three Sabbaths out of the scripture, opening the scriptures. I love to read to a Jewish person. Try it. Isaiah 53, but don't tell them what you're reading from. And then when you get done reading, he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, the chastisement of our peace was upon him, with his stripes we are healed, all we like sheep have gone astray, we've turned everyone to his own way, but God, Jehovah, has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. He's despised and rejected of men. We esteemed him not, we rejected him. And you ask him, who are we reading about? Well, that's Jesus. But they think you're reading from some Christian book. Well, no, that's your great prophet Isaiah. And that was how Paul preached Christ. And he went into the synagogues and he opened the Jewish scriptures and he said, look what your prophets have said and look what happened to Jesus. It has been fulfilled in his life, in his death, in his rejection, in his betrayal, and in his resurrection. He is the Christ, the Messiah. And that's the way we must preach Christ. Romans chapter 1, Paul talks about the gospel of God. Somebody says, you're offending my religion. Well, I'm sorry, if it's your religion, it ought to be offended. What you need is God's religion. And it's not religion, it's the gospel of God. It's a relationship with God that you need. Testified, Paul says, by the law and by the prophets concerning his son, Jesus Christ, raised from the dead. And we need to be very careful that we thoroughly identify Jesus and we explain to people who he is, why he came, what he did. And we base it soundly, as we must base everything upon the Word of God. We have the tools for evangelizing. Don't tell anybody who I am until the time comes, but now we must tell them who he is. And you know Matthew 28, go into all the world and make disciples of all nations and so forth. But then Jesus said something that startled his disciples. Verse 21, from that time forth, Jesus began to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. That was a negative confession, in case you haven't noticed it. And Jesus made a lot of negative confessions. For example, when people came running to him, said, Master, we'll follow you. Jesus said, the foxes have holes, the birds of the air have nests. I don't have anywhere to lay my head. He should have confessed a condominium. He should have confessed a large home. But he apparently brought upon himself, because you get what you say, he brought upon himself his own crucifixion and his own poverty by a negative confession. And apparently, he will yet bring upon this whole world, and we'll speak of this more in our next session, Armageddon, the Antichrist, the Great Tribulation. All of these were negative confessions that Jesus made. Are we supposed to undo them with a positive confession? Well, that's what Peter tried to do. Jesus was so negative, and Peter was very positive. And Peter said, Lord, I know it's discouraging, and I know things have been going bad for you lately. And he hadn't heard about a bad self-image, but he might have suggested that to the Lord as well, if he had. But Lord, you've got to keep a bright outlook on life. You've got to be optimistic. You've got to have a stiff upper lip. You've got to expect the best. You're not going to be crucified. Get thee behind me, Satan. Don't tell me positive is always good and negative is always bad. It's the truth that counts. And Jesus was speaking the truth. Now, why did he say, get thee behind me, Satan? I mean, he had just commended Peter for being inspired of his Father. Notice verse 23. Get thee behind me, Satan, thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not or understandest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. You can be inspired by God one moment, and you can be totally out in left field the next moment. And when we try to correct someone for false doctrine, we're not saying they're not Christians, we're not saying everything they've ever said or done is wrong, but we're saying you can be right on some things and wrong on something very important. And here was Peter, who had a revelation from the Father that Jesus is the Christ. But he didn't know what it meant. He didn't know that the Messiah had to die. He didn't understand. And it brings us back to the emphasis that we need upon an understanding in the church today and a clear adherence to the Word of God and the truth of God and a willingness to be rebuked or reproved in any area where we err, where we depart from the truth of Scripture. But notice what he says, you don't understand the things of God, you are thinking like a man. And that is the great problem again in the church today. We've got a lot of Peters who had some insights from God, but they have begun to pick up the ideas of the world about them, and they apply them to Christ, they apply them to the church, they apply them to the gospel, they apply them to the Word of God, and they're thinking like men, and they're putting human wisdom, and that's the glasses that they put on by which they read this book. And they are perverting the truth and the purity, the simplicity that is in Jesus Christ. The hope of this world is in Jesus Christ alone. We say amen to that. We believe it. But let's begin to live it. And let's begin to stand for this. and not allow any compromise whatsoever. Jude, verse 3 says that we are to earnestly contend for the faith once for all delivered to the saints. We're not to be contentious, but we must contend earnestly. And we're not to allow it to be diluted or polluted or perverted. We must stand for the truth as Jesus himself, and he would not allow a misunderstanding, not for one moment. He would not allow a dilution or perversion. He would not be turned from what he knew had to be accomplished. He had to die. There was no other way. We believe this as evangelicals. No other way except for Jesus to die, or we could not be forgiven of our sins. But I think too often we begin to suggest that there is another way for us to live the Christian life, that Jesus is not enough. We need psychotherapy. We need some help from here or from there. We need some good success motivation training or whatever. What we need is the simplicity that is in Jesus Christ. We need to let him be Lord of our lives and let him be our life and live his life through us. Why did Jesus have to die? We studied back in Genesis chapter 3. And you remember, when God cast Adam and Eve out of the garden, he put a flaming sword to keep the way to the tree of life. Cherubim with a flaming sword to keep the way to the tree of life. Lest Adam and Eve partake of it and live forever, because he would not perpetuate man in his fallen condition. And people today are trying to turn this world back into a paradise without passing that flaming sword. They're trying to climb up another way, Jesus said. They are thieves and robbers. They're trying to solve our ecological problems, our political problems, our our economic problems without Jesus Christ. And we all fled from that sword. In fact, we complained about that sword. And you have complaint today against the death penalty, one of the big complaints in our land, against the death penalty. God says, the soul that sinneth, it must die. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. And God says that the blood of the victims of murder cries from the very ground unto God, and the judgment will come. And we must mete out that judgment. You want to oppose the death penalty? Then you will have to oppose the death of Jesus Christ upon the cross, without which there is no hope, no solution. Because when Jesus stood in our place, he was put to death for us. In fact, Isaiah 53 says, it pleased Jehovah to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin. We've mentioned briefly, there is a teaching in the Church of Jesus Christ that comes from E.W. Kenyon. You will get it in his book, What Happened Between the Cross and the Throne, who is the founder, the real founder of the Positive Confession Movement, whose writings were plagiarized by Kenneth Hagin and so forth. And Kenneth Copeland, I quoted it. I want to read it. I'm reading from an explanatory letter that comes out from Kenneth Copeland Ministries. And let me just quote to you. When his, that is, Christ's blood poured out, it did not atone. Kenneth Copeland and these others teach that the work of redemption began on the cross, but our redemption comes through Christ taking on the nature of Satan, being identified with Satan, becoming a helpless, hopeless, sinful man, falling into the depths of hell where he was tortured for 3 days and three nights by Satan. And that is where our redemption comes from. That's not true. The Bible always identifies redemption with the cross and with the blood. Redemption in his blood. The forgiveness of sins. Let me give you some of the scriptures. Leviticus, beginning way back in the Old Testament. Leviticus 17, verse 11. The life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it for you upon the altar, for it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul. All of the Old Testament sacrifices look forward to Christ. From the Passover on, and the blood that would be shed upon the cross, the Lamb of God who would bear away the sin of the world. We quoted it from Isaiah 53. Thou, Jehovah, hast made his soul an offering for sin. It wasn't Satan. Suppose Satan didn't torture Jesus enough. Supposing our salvation hangs by this thread, whether Satan tortured him enough. And supposing he did torture him enough, are we to thank Satan for doing it? He has become co-redemptor of the human race, along with Jesus, because he is the one whose efforts made our redemption possible by torturing Jesus to the fullest extent. John the Baptist hailed the Lamb of God. In Luke 22, verse 20, and 1 Corinthians 11, 25, Jesus talks about the new covenant in my blood. In my blood. Jeremiah 31, 31, the time is coming when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel. And Jesus said, this is it, and it is in my blood. Acts 20, verse 28, speaks of the church that was purchased with his blood. The blood was shed upon the cross, not in hell, under the torture of Satan. Romans 3, verse 25, in whom we have redemption. It speaks redemption through his blood, is Colossians 1, 14 and Ephesians 1, 7. But Romans 3, 25, it is through faith in his blood that we're redeemed. And Romans 5, verse 9, we are justified by his blood. Hebrews 9, verse 22, again, quotes from the Old Testament, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. And 1 Peter 1, 19, you know the verse well, says we are bought with a price, with the precious blood of Christ. And of course, Revelation 7, 14 and 12, 11, they, that is we, his disciples, his redeemed, overcame Satan through his blood. Through the blood of the Lamb, through the word of their testimony, and loved not their lives unto death. He must die. There is no other way. And Jesus, in contrast to all men who fled that sword, that flaming sword, and who complained bitterly against the death penalty, the second man, there was never a man that walked the face of this earth who deserved to be called a man from the day that Adam was created fresh from the hand of God until the time when Jesus, the body of Jesus, was brought forth by the hand of God in the womb of a virgin. We were miserable creatures, fallen creatures, the image of God deformed and defiled in which we had been made. And I don't think Pilate knew what he meant, what he said, when he brought Jesus forth and said, behold the man. This is man as God intended him to be. Here he is. Here's the man, the second man. He's the second Adam, but he's called the last Adam, because there's not going to be a third and a fourth and a fifth. What Jesus has accomplished will never be undone. He is the progenitor of a new race, and we become the children of God through faith in his blood and through faith in him and through what he has done. And in contrast to all others who fled that sword, Jesus walked up and he took it in his heart for us. And the poet said, his blood, that flaming blade must quench. His heart, its sheath must be. And that's how he became the way for us to life. And you read in the last chapter of the Bible, a man back in the garden and with partaking of the tree of life. But it is through what Jesus accomplished. And there is no other way. That sword of judgment had to mete out justice upon our race. And we had to die. And that's why Jesus said, except you deny self, take up the cross and follow me, you cannot be my disciple. There is no other way. Something so horrible went wrong with the human race. The group therapy, psychotherapy, gritting your teeth, turning over a new year's leaf, a new year's resolution. Nothing is going to solve the problem. We have to be done away with. Self, the enemy, must be denied. We must be crucified with Christ. We must accept his death as our death. Oh, can it really be that bad? Well, take a look at the cross of Jesus Christ if you want to know how bad it is. Here comes the lovely Son of God, who should have been loved. Here comes the Creator of the universe. He comes to his own, and his own receive him not. He walks among his creatures. They spit upon him. They hated me without a cause. They beat him. They mock him. They scourge him. And they nail him to a cross. You want to see the horror of sin? We're not talking about white lies. We're not talking about something that you can solve by turning over a new leaf or by determining to live a moral life. We're talking about something that is so deeply rooted in the human heart that has gone so horribly wrong that we would take God Himself and tear Him from His throne and crucify Him. There were many people who wanted to make Him a king, you remember? John 6, you read about it. They were going to take Him by force and make Him a king. Imagine taking someone by force and making him be your king. Why? Because they wanted to be healed. They wanted to be fed. But they were not willing. They were going to make Him a figurehead, but they were not willing to let Him be Lord. And I believe there were many people in the crowd that day that crucified Him who had been healed by Jesus, who had been fed by Jesus, but who cried, "Away with Him! Crucify Him! We will not have this man reign over us." Because when they began to see the full implications of what it meant to receive Him as the Messiah, they were not willing to let Him be Lord of their lives. They were not willing to give up self. They, the Jews, of course, were looking for a Messiah who would ride on a white horse and who would conquer the Romans. They thought their enemies were out there. They didn't know the enemy was within. And they were not willing to accept that solution. And you want to see the horror of the human heart, see what we did. And I tell you, it ought to make all of us tremble with fear and hang our heads with shame, because it was our sins that nailed Him there. And there are people who today who would tell you that it is the blood of Christ shed upon the cross that determines my worth. No, it was the blood of Christ that had to be shed because of my sin. It was because of my unworthiness, not because of my worth, that He had to die for me. And we ought to tremble for what God is going to do, the judgment He will do to this earth, because we kicked the Messiah off of this earth. But He's coming back in power one of these days, and in judgment. And as we take the cup, and Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me," I often think of it, and the bread, I have no right to be there. It's my sins, but you know what? He invites us. He pleads with us. He pleads with those who have not received Him. From the cross, He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Did you ever think and meditate upon the fact that the very nails that pierced His hands and the very spear that pierced His side in contempt and anger drew forth the blood that saves? As man vented his hatred, Jesus responded with redemption and in love. And we are to do the same. We need to meditate more upon the cross of Jesus Christ. We need to understand what happened. We need to give ourselves for Him and to others in His service. I think that was what convicted Saul of Tarsus, at least one of those things that did, as he held the clothes of those who stoned Stephen that day. And Stephen, with a shining countenance, being stoned to death, cried out, "Lord, don't charge them with this crime." He saw the very love of the crucified one living again in Stephen. And something said, a voice must have said, the voice of the Holy Spirit, "He's right and you are wrong. He has something that you don't have. It's the hope, the only hope of this world. He's right, you're wrong, Saul." And yet we become occupied with ourselves. And Dave Wilkerson recently said, "Go to any bookstore and count the number of books dealing with human hurts, such as depression, fear, rejection, divorce, remarriage, loneliness. Attend nearly any seminar or crusade, and you will hear much insight on how to cope with personal pain and distress. Yet how little is written or taught about sharing the sufferings of Jesus Christ the Lord." We used to sing the old rugged cross, "Its shame and reproach gladly bear." But we're trying to take the shame and the reproach away from the cross of Jesus Christ. Dave Wilkerson again said, "The way of the cross is the surrender of all that is dear to us in this life." You know what some of the old hymns have said? "I must needs go home by the way of the cross." You know that hymn? "There's no other way but this. I can ne'er get sight of the gates of light if the way of the cross I miss." The way of the cross leads home. The way of the cross leads home. And I fear that, and I speak to my own heart, that many of us know too little of the cross in our daily lives. Robert Schuller has another view of the cross. He says, are we to believe that self-denial means the denial of personal pleasure, desire, fulfillment, prosperity? For too long, religious leaders have suggested this with tragic results. Such attitudes are dangerous distortions and destructive misinterpretations of scattered Bible verses grossly misread by negative-thinking Bible readers who project their own negative self-image onto the pages of Holy Scripture. By self-denial, Christ does not mean the rejection of that positive emotion we call self-esteem. And then he goes on to tell us, a neurotic fear of pride has motivated the church too long. In my lectures to thousands of ordained clergy of the widest cross-section of historic Christianity, I have found it necessary to tell my colleagues, dare to be a possibility thinker. Do not fear pride. The easiest job God has is to humble us. God's almost impossible task is to keep us believing every hour of the day how great we are as His sons and daughters on planet Earth. Don't worry about humility. The easiest job God has to do is to keep you and me humble. Remember, if your pride is rooted in your divine call, your humility is assured, and the cross will sanctify your ego trip. I don't think that's the gospel of Jesus Christ. I don't think that's the preaching of the cross that is foolishness to those who perish. Elizabeth Elliot, you remember, tells of her life with Jim, her husband, and how they went to the Alka Indians in South America. Her husband was killed, and how she eventually lived with them. She says, during all the years that I have recounted the story and reflected on it in the light of subsequent experience, one lesson above all others shines, God is God. If He is God, He is worthy of my worship, my trust, my obedience. I am only a child. He is my Father. He will not explain everything, but I may find rest in His glorious will. His will is infinitely, immeasurably, ineffably beyond my largest notions of what He is up to, but I will find rest nowhere else. There's much that we can't understand. There's much about the cross. There's much about the way of suffering, the path that the Lord wants us to follow Him in, that we don't understand. I remember Decision Magazine some years ago, there was a little poem, and I don't remember it, but it ended something like this. You left us the command to follow your footsteps, Lord, but how can we do it? Because the only footsteps that you left on the sands of time led to the cross. And Jesus said to Peter and his disciples, you can't follow me now. Peter boasted, though all forsake you, yet will not I. Jesus said, Peter, you don't know what you're saying. You are going to deny me before the cock crows. You can't follow me now, but I'm going to do something that will become real for you. And after my resurrection, I will come and live in you. And you can deny yourself. You can take up the cross. And you can know the power of the cross and of self-denial and of resurrection. But I have to do it for you, Peter. You can't do it. And then you have to believe me and have to understand who I am and what I've come to do and why. I was awakened one night about 2 a.m. And I don't consider myself a poet, but I have tried to write a few little pieces of poetry from time to time. But this night the words seemed to flow out, and I want to just end with this poem. It's titled Love in Sandaled Feet. And it goes something like this. Love invaded space and time and history, hung the stars in place, stooped down a man. Oh, mystery. Chose no palace, but a stable for his lowly birth. Love in sandaled feet had come to walk this earth. Strange new words were spoken by a bearded Jew. Do unto others as you'd have them do to you. Love your enemies, and you must be born again. Love in sandaled feet had come to talk with men. Love in sandaled feet, sweaty, muddy feet, God and man at last could meet. Having been so long, so very long apart, tired legs, a throbbing human heart, stagger up a lonely hill to die, pounding nails and quivering flesh, a cry. Forgive them, Father, no one understands. Love in nail-pierced feet and bleeding outstretched hands. Those who fled in fear return to say, He lives, millions here. Receive the life and peace He gives. Hate is turned to love, and enemies are brothers. Love in sandaled feet lives now in many others. That's what the gospel and Christianity is all about. The simplicity that is in Jesus Christ alone, in Him alone, and we need to get back to this in our daily lives, in what we share with others, in our communication, and in our churches, in our Christian books and films, and magazines, whatever it is.